Hi, LiJia. Thank you so much for joining us today for Hoya Gateway's virtual Power Lunch interview. We're excited to ask questions from Georgetown students to learn more about your career. A little bit about LiJia before we get started. LiJia is a double Hoya from the School of Foreign Service and Law School. Currently serving as counsel at Public Rights Project, LiJia has a background in litigation, public policy, and political strategy. LiJia developed her litigation experience as an associate at Frankfurt, Kurnit, Klein and Selz, and Davis, Polk, and Wardwell. She has represented clients in nearly all phases of litigation in cases before state and federal courts. In her broad practice, she has worked on matters that range from antitrust to white-collar criminal defense to intellectual property and complex commercial litigation. Prior to joining PRP, LiJia worked on the 2018 campaign to re-elect Senator Elizabeth Warren of Massachusetts. LiJia served as a law clerk for Judge Kiyo Matsumoto of the U.S. District Court for the Eastern District of New York and as a law fellow for Senator Richard Blumenthal of Connecticut. LiJia has expertise and interest in leveraging data and statistics to further litigation and policy goals, which she first developed as a research assistant at the Federal Reserve Board of Governors. In that role, LiJia worked on economic models that forecasted spending in residential and non-residential sectors of the U.S. economy. And now we'll dive straight into questions. LiJia, what did you do immediately following graduation to set yourself up for a career in law?
Great question. First of all, I'm so grateful to be doing this and excited to be speaking to the great Georgetown students who are thinking about their next steps. So as Jihei said, right after college, I worked at the Federal Reserve Board of Governors, and I actually didn't really necessarily know or think that I was going to go to law school after I graduated. I actually thought I might be interested in pursuing a PhD in economics and becoming an economist. I was an international political economy major, and so that's why I ended up going to the Federal Reserve, where I did a lot of statistical and economics work. So I think maybe the takeaway for right after graduation is you don't necessarily need to know that you're going to go to law school. But in that experience, I learned a lot about the U.S. economy and also like how to pay a lot of attention to detail as a young research assistant. And those are all aspects of my experience that I've leveraged in many other steps that I've taken in my career. So I think my advice to students is that you don't necessarily need to know for a fact that you're going to go to law school right when you graduate, but that whatever role you take after graduation should, you know, be something that you can learn from and can be challenging, and then you can leverage hopefully those experiences into your legal career in some way.
Thank you so much for sharing that. The next question we have here is, what advice do you have for aspiring law students who want to practice law in nonprofit roles?
I went into public interest and nonprofit lawyering, doing impact litigation a little bit of a roundabout way. When I graduated from law school, I wanted to pay off loans and learn how to litigate. And I did that at a law firm. But what kind of brought me back into public interest work, in addition to kind of great interest and just the values that I've always shared for a passion for social justice, which, you know, I was involved in a lot of organizations in college and have continued to kind of stay engaged in those issues. But what kind of set me up to be back in that nonprofit and public interest lawyering space was really the internships that I did in law school. So I think I'll talk a little bit more about my experience with Senator Warren, but when I was in law school, I was served as a legal fellow, a legal intern on the Hill with Senator Blumenthal of Connecticut. And the legislative director there became a mentor and friend, and he went on to go work for Senator Warren. And I kind of maintained that connection. And even though I wasn't living in DC after law school, every time I'd be back in town, I'd ask to get coffee. And so I think setting yourself up even for a public interest career, I think there's lots of different ways. You know, there's public interest resources depending on the law school you go to. But I think one way you can certainly do it is just by choosing really interesting internship opportunities that are in the public interest and making sure you stay in touch with those people and the people that you connect with, so that even if you start off your career not in the nonprofit or public interest space, there's an opportunity to go into that space because you have connections and know people who are working in that space.
How did you make the transition from a traditional law firm to working for public rights projects?
Yeah, and I touched on this a little bit before, but my legal career started out as at a big law firm, and then I went to clerk, which is something that a lot of young lawyers do. And, you know, you work for a judge, and you have the opportunity to draft memos and opinions, and it's kind of seen as a very good training for young lawyers, young litigators in particular. And then after that, I went to a smaller law firm, I think for a bunch of reasons. I think large law firms, you don't always have the opportunity to get as much hands-on experience because teams are really big and young lawyers just don't have that much opportunity to have really interesting like experiences writing or arguing things. And so I went to a smaller law firm for some of those reasons, to get better experiences and to really have the opportunity to practice my skills. But I think the 2016 election, I think probably for a lot of people, was a little bit of a moment where I had to reconsider what were my values and what did I really go to law school for? What did I get this law degree for? And it felt like the time to transition to doing public interest work. And so at that time, it felt like electoral work felt so important. I was just like, we need to win elections or else, you know, we cannot have the kind of world that we want. And so I reached out, as I mentioned, to someone who I had interned for in law school, who I knew was working for Senator Warren and, you know, had a fair amount of experience both on the Hill and in campaigns. And that was when he told me, well, interestingly enough, I have this job on Senator Warren's campaign that I think you might be very well suited for. And so that led me to the campaign. And then subsequently, I went to Public Rights Project, which, I mean, I think between the work that I had done in law school and the skills that I had built clerking and in the law firms, I think I was like really well poised to apply for jobs in public interest, nonprofit spaces, because I had both litigation experience and I'd also worked on a campaign and demonstrated that, you know, I had the values and was mission oriented in a way that I think a lot of those organizations are looking for, like some sort of commitment to social justice values, the mission of the organization, et cetera.
Thank you so much for sharing that, LiJia. What was it like to work on Elizabeth Warren's campaign in 2018? What did your day-to-day schedule look like, and what did you enjoy most about it?
So I had a little bit of a funny job on Senator Warren's campaign. I think very few people know this. I didn't know this until very recently, but one aspect of campaigns, so I think most people think of political campaigns as a lot of field organizers running out and knocking on doors. That was not what I was doing. I was asked to lead a little team within a larger research team. And research is probably, on a campaign, is very different than what I think most students would think of the word research to mean. Research is oftentimes mostly opposition research. So it's kind of digging up the dirt about the people that your candidate is running against. But then in the case for Senator Warren, it was also what we called self-research. So that's research about her own background. Because she was a law professor before going into politics, a large part of what needed to be understood was her work as a law professor and as a lawyer taking on clients here and there, especially in the beginning of her legal career. So the work that I did was really kind of spending a lot of time looking into her legal work. And what my day-to-day meant was I had a small team. I had a paralegal and a younger lawyer who I supervised. And so I would start the day with a team meeting just to check in what everyone was working on. And then really the rest of the day, for the most part, was digging into the documents and summarizing and kind of developing strategy and anticipating what attacks might look like. And then, you know, sometimes this happened very rarely, but sometimes I did get to, you know, meet with the senator to kind of talk with her about some of these issues or meet with my supervisor and other senior members of the team to kind of think about how we can anticipate potential attacks and how we would kind of deal with those things. So yeah, it was actually in many ways a quite an academic experience, which is, I think, very different from what most campaigns are like, but it was a really interesting window into the campaign. And what I loved most about it was that I think, frankly, it's just, there's nothing really like working for someone who you really like, I admire and believe in. And I think that was probably one of the best parts, was working for Senator Warren and getting to, you know, not that I spent a lot of time with her, but in the time that I did get to spend with her, I think it always left me feeling really inspired and motivated.
The next question here is, what do you find most rewarding about your current role?
there's so much that's rewarding about my current role, and I should just share a little bit more about it because I realize that my bio does not explain that much of what I do. But as counsel at Public Rights Project, I do a whole range of things. Our organization is focused on supporting state and local governments to protect civil rights, consumers, and workers and the environment. So I think some of you all may know that state attorneys general have been really active, for example, in suing the Trump administration, but also kind of state and local governments do a lot to protect low-wage workers from wage theft, make sure that housing quality is good. There are a lot of things that state and local governments do to protect residents, and our work is really kind of thinking about ways to support those state and local governments and also sometimes defending them and representing those governments as our clients and sometimes co-litigating with them. So we're co-counsel with them on cases. So I think what's really rewarding about my job is one of the best parts about my job is that I get to do so many different things and wear so many different hats. I get to write briefs. I get to, you know, kind of do what we think of as like core litigating work, but I also get to do trainings for government lawyers. I also get to do a lot of facilitation. I get to do a lot of like strategic thinking for if we want to make a difference on this issue, what kind of campaign do we build? And so I think that's one thing that's really great about the job is like, there's just a lot of diversity in my day-to-day and the type of work that I do. And I think what's really rewarding is I feel a lot of pride in helping others to learn to do the work and to help to steer and support local government lawyers to think more, can you do more to protect these vulnerable people in your communities? Is there a really interesting, exciting case that you've been wanting to bring that you haven't been able to bring because of your bureaucratic, you know, difficulties, like let's think through those problems. I think just helping other people kind of realize their potential and do really impactful work is super rewarding to me.
Thank you so much for sharing that and a little bit more about your current role. Follow up with that question, what are the challenges you face in your role?
Many of the challenges stem from the fact that I work at a startup nonprofit. We are 2.5 years old. The challenges really are the opportunities as well. I think we are so nimble. For example, right when COVID-19 hit, we immediately pivoted to thinking, okay, what can state and local governments do to protect vulnerable people in the time of COVID-19? And we did a bunch of webinars, especially on like protecting workers and worker safety, as well as thinking about housing and how to make sure that eviction moratoriums are being enforced so that vulnerable people are not on the streets or doubling up in another apartment, so that which will only continue to aggravate both the public health emergency and put, you know, already vulnerable people at risk. And that was amazing that we were able to pivot so quickly and really just do the work that needed to be done right then. That said, I think sometimes it can feel a little bit like we're just turning from one thing to another. And is there kind of a broader direction that we are aiming towards? And sometimes it can feel a little, we're working on a little bit on this thing and a little bit on that thing, and that there's like not enough depth always. So I think the challenge is how do we continue to stay nimble while also continue to build expertise and be strategic without making it feel like we're just very shallowly engaging on a lot of different types of issues. And I think that's a challenge that a lot of young organizations have to deal with. I think these are kind of big questions about or how organizations are run, but I feel mostly grateful that I get to engage in them, but sometimes they can be challenging for sure.
Thank you so much for sharing. Did you feel imposter syndrome at all going through law school and working at large law firms? If you did, how did you work through it?
You know, that's a really good question that I've been thinking about a little bit. And I think I personally have not felt a ton of imposter syndrome. That said, I have felt in very many spaces as someone who is an immigrant, a non-white person, first, you know, no one in my family went to law school. I have felt certainly like an outsider or like this space was not familiar to me. I think I've always felt some sort of confidence in my ability to kind of like observe and learn and grow. So I don't think I've exactly felt imposter syndrome. That said, I have felt, I think, very like outside and confused about what is this like white shoe law firm and that's existed since, you know, for hundreds of years and is like really, you know, you go to these offices in Manhattan and there's the library is full of, you know, pictures of old dead white men and feeling a little bit like, do I belong here? And what is this place really? And I think for me, dealing with those feelings of, I don't really belong here, or this isn't really for me, has always been a lot about finding other mentors and people. I mean, and oftentimes there are women, there are people of color who had been in that space for longer and, you know, looking to them. And I think both for guidance and also just someone else to kind of roll your eyes sometimes when, you know, you recognize that the culture of a place does not fully encompass who you are as a person. But I also understand that imposter syndrome is real. And I will just say, as someone who has, you know, clerked and been in a lot of prestigious spaces, I just feel like all people have something to bring to kind of, especially the work that I do of building social justice movements and like doing social justice work, that everyone's perspective and like willingness to be in the fight is valued and that everybody brings their own perspectives and intelligence to the table and that you shouldn't feel that just because you haven't had the same background as someone else, that you don't have an extremely valuable thing to bring to the table. Because actually, if anything, if you're different from everybody else in the room, your perspective is like thousands of times more valuable because you're going to be able to spot the thing that, you know, everyone else is missing because they all went to the same types of schools and, you know, had the same types of experiences. So I say that you should learn to build confidence in yourself, but also recognize that there's a huge need for people who are not exactly the same to be in all of these spaces, you know, and that doesn't mean just conforming and assimilating, but also being yourself.
What can Georgetown students do to make the most of their time before they go into their careers?
I really think that the things that I most, that were most valuable to me from my college experience were A, just really learning about things that I thought were interesting and developing strong analytical skills, which, you know, depending on what career you're going into may or may not be important, but certainly being a lawyer, learning how to write well and how to analyze questions in a logical way were really useful to me. But I think what really I took the most out of college are really the relationships and the people that I met. I mean, one of my dear friends from college works now at the National Women's Law Center, and we have the opportunity to work together all the time and find ways to support each other in our work. And that's because it's been, you know, over a decade of friendship. And, you know, all of the times like getting drinks at the Tombs or whatever, like all of that builds over time. And I know that I can trust her in so many different ways. And so I think really investing in relationships in college is certainly, I think, one of the things that are most important to set you up for your career. But I also think like college for me was a time to just do, I mean, I think obviously there's a part of going to college that is about preparing yourself for careers, but also taking the advantage of like intellectual curiosity and taking advantage of learning things that you're interested in, because you might not have the chance always to do it in quite the same way as you move forward. But I also found I did a lot of extracurricular activities in college. I was on the SAC board. I really was one of those people who was always running around to Levy Center all the time. And I think a lot of the skills that I learned there about leadership and how to work with other people, how to run a meeting, those sorts of things are really, really relevant to my professional life every single day. I facilitate meetings all the time. And those sorts of skills are, I also did, I think I had a leg up from probably some other people who entered the workforce with, you know, just having been spending time in a purely academic scenario. So I think to the extent you're interested in a career that is about, you know, collaboration and teamwork, those sorts of experiences in college, I think, can be really, really valuable.
Thank you for sharing that. And the final question we have here for you, LiJia, is what advice do you have for Hoyas who have just graduated this year, the class of 2020?
Oh my God, class of 2020. Congrats. And I know it is an incredibly difficult and uncertain time to be graduating. I cannot imagine how it must feel. But that, with that said, I will say that I graduated in 2008. That was right when the economy had just collapsed because of the financial crisis. And I know you all are too young to really remember that, probably, in many ways. It was a huge recession. And interestingly enough, I went to work at the Federal Reserve, where we could see how nobody had predicted the housing market would collapse. And I will just say that I think the advice is really about resilience and how to build resilience within yourself, because I saw a lot of classmates struggle after I graduated because the macro, you know, the reality was it was nobody's fault. It just was, I mean, there was people at fault probably for the financial crisis, but certainly it was not the students' fault that there were not enough jobs. But I think a lot of what it took for people to kind of move past difficulties in the first few years of looking for work or finding meaningful work was just a sense of resiliency, of being able to kind of bend and be flexible. And also, like, when you are knocked down, to be able to get up again. And it's okay to lick your wounds a little and feel a little bit sorry for yourself, but also to just, like, keep on keeping on. And I think what that really means is making sure you have a community of people who care about you and are making sure that all your needs are being met on a basic level, and then continuing to find the ability within yourself, to apply for jobs and apply for grad school and do all of those things. But so I don't know if that was the most helpful. I think the takeaway also, as someone who graduated in a difficult time, is that most of my classmates are doing well, and that I feel confident that most of you, all of you, will do well. It just might be a little bit more of a rougher time in the first few years. But I think if you have a good community, if you're resilient, that you guys will make it. And, like, regardless, it's a huge accomplishment already to have graduated from college. And there's so much more of the world for you guys all to see and to contribute to. I really do think that, like, career and work is one of the few ways that we have to, like, make a meaningful impact in the world. And for me, really, to, like, serve underserved people. And that's an opportunity too. And there will always be those opportunities.
Thank you so much for sharing that, LiJia. And thank you so much for your time today.